Well, I appreciated several things that I've heard already this morning. I appreciated some of the prayer requests as well. They speak to my heart well this morning. Those of you who are with us in Sabbath school, you've got to hear Brother Mike at the end play his recorder. Right, it's not a trumpet. Our talk today is giving the trumpet a certain sound. I don't have a trumpet. But if we had a trumpet here today, and I tried to play that trumpet, it probably would be a discordant note, not very sweet to hear. But there is a theologicalness to giving the trumpet the certain sound. Ellen White uses this phraseology a few hundred times in her writings. It's not a minor motif. In fact, she says in Christian Education on page 155, the trumpet must give a certain sound. There is a broad, clear, and deep line drawn by the eternal God between the righteous and unrighteous, the godly and the ungodly, between those who are obedient to God's commandments and those who are disobedient. She says there is a broad, clear, and deep line. If I had thought, I would put a picture in here that I took this last Thursday. It was on the Appalachian Trail in Virginia, and there was a place where we were at an area called Tinker's Cliffs, and there were these two rocks, and there was a narrow, not easy to see, but semi-deep break between these two rocks. It'd be easy to step in that break and hurt your leg or something. My whole body might fall through, in fact. But not so with God. What he has is clear. It's broad and distinct. Now today, the Bible is being challenged as never before. And you're thinking, sure, there's evolutionistic teachings, humanism is being taught. But friends, it's not simply the veracity of the Bible itself that the Bible is being so challenged in, but rather through improper interpretation.
Amen.
Through improper interpretation. Under the guise of openness, generosity, love, under the pretext of not being selfish, false theology is cowardly being allowed to be presented instead of boldly standing up to deny false doctrines and to condemn heresy. Today I want to talk to you about theology, son. And what the Bible says about the importance of proper theology. And I want to begin by just looking at an outline of the four major branches of theology. Just so you have a little background in this. And we'll make these slides available. In fact, they're already available online at smyrna.org. If you'd like to have these slides available, just go to our website on the homepage. There's a direct link for the sermon slides of today. They're available for you. But the first branch of theology I'd just like to mention is called exegetical theology. And exegetical theology can be subdivided and then subdivided more. And we're just looking at some of the main branches that might have a pertinence to you. But the first is biblical studies, analysis of the context of the scripture itself. Biblical introduction, biblical criticism that studies the origins of the Bible. There's canonics, or the inquiry into how the different books of the Bible came to be collected together. You know, we call all these books together the canon. So this is the canonics. How did we get all these different books? Why, for instance, do we not have the Apocrypha in the King James Bible today, for instance? And then there's biblical theology inquiring into how divine revelation progressed over the course of the Bible. Another area of theology is historical theology, or the study of how Christian theology develops over time. For instance, you have those first 8 centuries of the Christian era, broken into 3 parts, the Antinicene Fathers, the Nicene Fathers, and the Post-Nicene Fathers. And it's an interesting place to make a pivot there, isn't it? The Council of Nicaea. The Middle Ages, the Reformation and Counter-Reformation theologies, the modern period coming down to our day, and then even eschatology and the afterlife is considered by some people to be a form of the historical theology. And then we have what we call the practical theology that can be studied. And in practical theology, we have the things that may seem practical. For instance, Christian ethics, moral theology, ecclesiology, the study of the church and how the church functions. And that actually has an overlap that you will see a little bit later also. Pastoral theology, liturgics, the homiletics, Christian education, Christian counseling, how the pastor works and moves and helps the congregation, and of course, missionology. What is our biblical theory of doing sharing, missionary work, spreading the gospel? You know, the old Matthew chapter 28, verses 19 and 20 situation. And then we have what I like so much. We have systematic theology, and we have two different slides on it. This is the first one. We have systematic theology. And this is the first section is called Theology Proper. And this deals with the existence of God, his attributes. Most people here, instead of the Father and Son, would put the Trinity. But I'll put Father and Son here. Creation, his divine providence. These are all parts of what we consider systematic theology. Systematic theology, the idea that you have all these different doctrines that interlock together, build together, but you have certain foundational doctrines that all the other doctrines then build upon. Also in systematic theology, we have the doctrine of man, or theological anthropology. We have Christology, soteriology, and under soteriology, you'll notice two that you're very familiar with, justification, sanctification, right? But you also have here harmartiology, which is the study of sin, the nature of sin, and then pneumatology, the study of the Holy Spirit, and another ecclesiology, the doctrine of the church and how the church fits into the functioning of these things as well. Does the church itself become a doctrine of itself? Now, the main components, and all these are studied, all these are considered in Adventism, of course, but the main components in Adventist theology of our fundamentals, are really broken into four parts: the Christology, the soteriology, the eschatology, and the exegetical theology, or what really makes up inspiration. That is such a vital issue to Adventists. Do we believe that God has given us the Bible and the Bible alone for our doctrines, and yet at the same time, do we also make room for the spiritual gifts to be added to the church, such as we'll look at a little bit later in Ephesians 4, 1 Corinthians 12, 14, Revelation 12, 17, Revelation 19, 10. Is there an additional room for any of that to be considered as we study? Now, I believe with all my heart, because the Bible teaches us, and we're going to see it, that our theology is important and it is vital. And when I say our theology, we could even substitute the word doctrine. Our doctrine, our teachings, because our teachings in Christianity are supposed to be theological teachings. We don't teach you here how to invest in the stock market. We don't teach you here, and I'm not saying there's anything wrong with it, but the main thing of what we don't teach you here is even how to grow a garden. Growing a garden is important, maybe. But that's not really the teaching of the Bible itself, you see. I mean, Ahab had wanted a herb garden, I guess. So, you know. But what we are interested in is what the Word of God says, and then following what the Word of God says. And I want to tell you right now that what the Word of God says and what the majority of the people say are almost always in contradistinction to each other. Did you get that? Mm-hmm. What the Bible says and what the majority of people say is almost always in contradistinction to each other, because the Bible says that it is the little flock. It said it is the narrow way and not the broad way. It is the few that go in and not the many. Keep that in mind. And that works not only in the main whole, but it works within the subdivisions pretty closely as well. Jesus said in John, if we could turn to John 7, 17. John chapter 7 and verse 17. And I'm going to give you time to turn there, because I want you to see what Jesus said. It's not important what I say today. It's going to be important what Jesus says. John 7, 17. Jesus said, "If any man will do his will, he shall know the doctrine, whether it be of God or whether I speak of myself." Now, this tells me something. It tells me that if I continually refuse to see or to understand some bit of truth, and I allow for a progression of understanding here. I allow for the fact that sometimes we have a lot of garbage in our minds, a lot of baggage that we have to clear out first, and sometimes we see truth, and yet it speaks truth, and we read the truth, but we don't receive it as truth. Because we got so much baggage in our minds, it takes a while to clear it out. Oh, God couldn't be telling me to keep the seventh-day Sabbath. I've been keeping Sunday all my life, for example. God couldn't be telling me he's the only true God because I've been worshiping the Trinity all my life. The church teaches the Trinity. It must be true, right? But what I'm saying is a continual rejection of truth. There comes a point and a time that it becomes a proof of our unwillingness to do the will of God. Either that is true or Jesus is wrong. Because that's what Jesus says here. He says, if any man will do his will, he shall know the doctrine. And so if I don't know the doctrine, friends, it's because either I haven't been educated to yet, and God will see that that happens, or I just haven't had my chance to clearly get rid of the garbage and the baggage in my mind to where I can clearly see the light. Because Jesus said, if you're willing to do his will, then you will know the doctrine. You don't have to be confused. God doesn't want his people to be confused. Now, I've heard it argued that it's okay to have a pluralistic view, if you please. It's okay to be liberal in allowing people to make different presentations that may or may not be right, because by doing this, it will cause us to think. And we could become deep thinkers like these people making presentations of heresy and error. Have any of you ever heard of a man by the name of Desmond Ford? Desmond Ford, virtually every one of us have heard of Desmond Ford, and he's still going. And this has been 37 years after Glacier View, the meeting that was held to defrock Ford and to deal with him. He's preaching heretical doctrines about our sanctuary on justification, no sanctification, theology. And yet, if you've ever heard Desmond Ford speak, the man can quote scripture after scripture. He speaks with eloquence. He speaks with great knowledge. You would say this man is a deep student. You see, friends, you can be a deep student per se. You can study a lot, and you can come up with all kinds of ideas, but it doesn't necessarily mean they're right.
That's right.
I was amazed the first time I heard Edward Heppenstall speak. Some of you may not know Heppenstall, but right in there with Ford, basically, on this theology. And I was amazed. This man was quoting verbatim, extemporaneously, scripture after scripture after scripture, quoting Ellen White's writings profusely. No notes, just pouring forth out of his mind. But you know what? He was taking many of them out of context or putting the wrong, dressing around it and teaching wrong theology. But he was a great student. And of course, he, in some respects, maybe did more damage than Froome or Anderson, because he was one of our great teachers in the seminary. You see, he taught the ministers the things that Froome and Anderson brought into the church. If you had lived a little more than 100 years ago, and you had been in an Adventist camp meeting, and Albion Fox Ballinger was preaching, you'd have said, that's a great preacher. That guy's a deep student of the Bible. But he was well off on the sanctuary. And Ellen White, in fact, she dealt with Ballinger differently than she had dealt with other people before. There were people before that she had to deal with, and she would give them scripture. She'd say, this scripture, whatever. But when she came to Ballinger, she didn't even try to do that. She says, you take a mass of scriptures and put them together with the wrong context. She just said simply, plainly to him, you're wrong. You're wrong. But he sounded good. And I'll tell you, if you had been one of those employees of the sanitarium about 100 plus years ago, you would have been terribly partial to John Harvey Kellogg and his theology. Was he a stupid man? Not by common standards in any way. He was probably a genius. I'm sure he was a genius, intellectually. But his theology became corrupt. And so, friends, just the idea that, well, someone is a good student. Friends, this fails to meet a biblical test. Because the Bible says to the law and to the testimony, Isaiah 20, they speak not according to this word, there's no light in them. And so just because we speak something that sounds good, just because we're preaching something that the majority of the people want to hear, doesn't make it right. It doesn't make it right. I just ask myself the question, what is wrong with us that we seem to fail to have the spiritual discernment that we need? Have we been drinking the toxic wine of Babylon so long that we just can't get sober? So really, according to the Bible, just how important is theology? How important are the teachings of the Bible? I'd invite you to turn to 2 Thessalonians chapter 2. 2 Thessalonians chapter 2 and verse 13. Paul says, "But we are bound to give thanks always to God for you, brethren, beloved of the Lord, because God hath from the beginning chosen you to salvation through sanctification of the Spirit and belief of the what? The truth." You see, it's believing what that brings salvation? It's believing truth. And it says also through the sanctification of the Spirit. But you know what? Jesus said we're sanctified through the truth. We're sanctified through the truth. And so, beloved, theology is important. And maybe you think that the branch of theology that we're talking about or being concerned with isn't as important as another. But I'm going to tell you, friends, man shall not live by bread alone, but by every word that proceeds from the mouth of God. Every word is important and every word is vital and necessary. In John 17, 17, we made allusion to this. We'll come back to it now. John 17, 17. Sanctify them through thy truth. Thy word is truth. And of course, it was the Spirit of God that gave us the truth, wasn't it? Holy men of God spake as they were moved by the Holy Ghost. And so this all comes back to the Word of God and to the theology. I mean, theology in its most basic fundamental definition is the study of God. And all of those subdivisions of theology are just other ways of looking at God, more detailed, focused ways of looking at God. All of our theology, all of it, friends, goes back somehow to God. And so we can say, well, this part of theology is not so dangerous, it's not so important, but I beg to differ with you, and I think Jesus will differ with you. In John chapter 8, verses 31 and 32, then Jesus said to those Jews which believed on him, "If ye continue in my word, then are ye my disciples indeed, and ye shall know error." Ye shall know false theology. You'll know heresies, and you'll be better by it. It'll make you a better student. Is that what it says?
No.
Jesus says, "And ye shall know the truth, and the truth shall make you free." You know, I remember in reading in Genesis, in the very first chapters of Genesis, that God made a beautiful world, and he put Adam and Eve in a beautiful garden, but there was one place off limits. And what was that one place that was off limits? The tree of knowledge of good and evil. But Satan's plan, friends, is to let us have some good, but we get evil mixed with it. And when we get that, we have confusion, we have problems, we lose, friends. We will lose.
That's right.
Don't ever forget that. The Apostle Paul believed that theology was important, and his greatest disciple was Timothy, student. And notice what he says. We'll look at a few verses here. In 1 Timothy chapter 4, verses 13 through 16, he says, "Till I come, give attendance to reading, to exhortation, to doctrine, to dogma, to the theology." And then he says, "Neglect not the gift that is in thee, which was given thee by prophecy with the laying on of the hands of the presbytery. Meditate upon these things, give thyself wholly to them, that thy profiting may appear to all. Take heed unto thyself and unto the doctrine. Continue in them, for in doing this thou shalt both save thyself and them that hear thee." And the implication is if you don't, then you're not going to be saved, and the people who hear you are going to be misled and confused. Now, friends, I ask you, am I being honest with the text? Is the text fair? Is the text wrong? Did the Holy Spirit make a mistake here through Paul? I don't believe so at all. 2 Timothy chapter 4, verses 1 and 2. He says, I charge thee therefore before God and the Lord Jesus Christ, who shall judge the quick and the dead at his appearing in his kingdom, preach the word. Be instant, in season, out of season, reprove, rebuke, exhort with all longsuffering and doctrine. You say, oh, but Brother Allen, I go to hear people and they preach the word. They preach the Bible all the time. So did Kellogg. So did Ballinger. So does Ford. So did Heppenstall. And you can list off a bunch of people from the world that you've heard about, you know, the Benny Hinns, the Joel Osteens. They claim to believe in the Bible. They claim to be teaching from the Bible, right? But friends, it has to line up with the law and the testimony. And I want to tell you this, that God has given us a truth that admits of no compromise. And as early as 1881, Ellen White made the emphatic statements found in volume 4 of the testimonies on page 595. She says, it's as sure that we have the truth as that God in heaven lives. And I believe that. And if we're coming up with new teachings today, then something is wrong. The Bible warns us against false doctrines. In Ephesians chapter 4 and verse 14, prior to this, he's been speaking about spiritual gifts, and God's given these spiritual gifts for a reason, that we come into the unity of faith and knowledge of the Son of God, into a perfect man. And then he says in verse 14, that we henceforth be no more children, tossed to and fro, carried about with every wind of doctrine, by the sly of men and the cunning craftiness whereby they lie in wait to deceive. Paul is saying here that there are people who are deceived by what he calls winds of doctrine. Winds of doctrine, they're just blowing through. But you know, he didn't get that idea on his own. If we go back to Jeremiah chapter 5, verses 11 through 13. He says, for the house of Israel and the house of Judah have dealt very treacherously against me, saith the Lord. They have belied the Lord and said, it is not he. Neither shall evil come upon us, neither shall we see sword nor famine. You remember that was sort of the popular teaching in Jeremiah's time. You know, the Babylonians are coming, but don't worry. We're not going to see any harm. God's going to watch over us. You know, the ship's going through. All those kind of things are being said. But notice now, and the prophets shall become wind, and the word is not in them. Thus shall it be done unto them. He says that these prophets who have this wind in them, that they don't have the word of God. And so a wind of doctrine, friends, is simply a teaching that is not based in the word of God. Not based in the word of God at all. Now, we were in Timothy, and we should go back to Timothy now. I'm going to go to 1 Timothy 4:1. Paul says, now the Spirit speaketh expressly. When you speak expressly, is it clear? Is it forceful? Is there emphasis? The Spirit speaketh expressly, that in the latter times some shall depart from the faith, giving heed to seducing spirits and doctrines of devils. I hate to tell you this, friends, but this is the truth. That when you hear these people giving these false teachings, these winds of doctrines, they didn't devise them on their own. They're not original with those people. According to the Word of God, they're doctrines of devils, friends. They're doctrines that come from the pit of hell. That's what it says. And they become popular in 2 Timothy. 2 Timothy chapter 4, verses 3 and 4. He says, for the time will come when they will not endure sound, what?
Doctrine.
Or theology. But after their own lust shall they heap to themselves teachers having itching ears, and they shall turn away their ears from the truth and shall be turned unto what?
Fables.
They have itching ears and they like the popular things. You know, a lot of people have invited people like Desmond Ford to meetings because he's popular and people like to hear him. And that was a good excuse to do that, they thought. Do you think that was a good excuse?
No.
So what if it's not Desmond Ford? What if it's Alan Stump and he's preaching wrong things? Should he be invited because the people want to hear him? They might not want to hear me, but they want to hear someone, right? So I'll just use me as an example. But friends, this principle is wrong, wrong, wrong. Isaiah chapter 30 and verse 10. I'll read verse 9 also. It says that this is a rebellious people, lying children, children that will not hear the law of the Lord, which say to the seers, See not, and to the prophets prophesy not unto us right things, speak unto us smooth things, prophesy deceits. People like to have their ears tickled, and they want to hear smooth things. They want to hear things that are pleasing to them. They want to hear popular things, and they're not interested as much in the truth. Of course we are. We give lip service to it. We say we love the truth. We believe the truth. We want to follow the truth. But friends, if any man will do his will, he shall know the doctrine, whether it be of God or not. And if we are not seeing with clarity here something is wrong, and there is an unwillingness somewhere in the heart to do the will of God. And that is what Jesus Christ says. And you can contradict me, you can disagree with me all you want, friends, but please do not contradict Jesus Christ. Now, I mentioned to you some branches of study within the theology that we were talking about. And I want to just look at a few of those branches for a few minutes, each one today, that are vital because they helped to form some of our most precious and dear fundamentals. One is soteriology. And I mentioned specifically hamartiology, which is the study of sin. Because, friends, if we don't get this right, then so many other things go wrong. As an example, in 1 John chapter 3 and verse 4, 1 John 3, 4. You know this text, I think. Whosoever committeth sin transgresses also the law, for sin is the transgression of the law. Do you believe that's true?
Amen.
Well, in Romans chapter 7 and verse 7, we have a confirmation of that. Romans chapter 7 and verse 7. Paul says, what shall we say then? Is the law sin? God forbid. Nay, I had not known sin, but by the law. What law, Paul? For I had not known lust, except the law had said, thou shalt not covet. He says, I wouldn't have known sin, but by the law. And the law he's speaking about here is not the Torah, not just the generic Pentateuch, or even the whole Bible, the whole Old Testament as a whole, because sometimes that would be called the law also. But he's very specifically talking about what here? The Ten Commandments. You tell me, beloved, you tell me where in the Ten Commandments it says that I'm born a sinner and that my nature is sin when I'm born. That I'm a sinner because of how I'm born. You show me in the Ten Commandments where it says that. Now, the Bible does teach, and we'll look at it in a minute, that we are born with a sinful, fallen nature. But friends, that doesn't make us of itself a sinner. And this has tremendous theological implications. Because if my nature is now sin, if I am born as a sinner, then this has practical implications upon Jesus and how he had to be born, and he could not be born like I was born. And so you have this soteriology, and it ties in then with the Christology, the very nature of Christ. Did he come to the bottom to save from the bottom up? Did Jesus really take our nature or not? Or is questions on doctrine correct when they declare that Jesus, and I quote, took sinless human nature, unquote. You see. Well, Romans chapter 8, and I'd like to just share this since we're close here. Romans chapter 8 and verses 3 and 4 says, for what the law could not do, in that it was weak through the flesh, God sending his own Son in the likeness of sinful flesh, and for sin condemned sin in the flesh, that the righteousness of the law might be fulfilled in us who walk not after the flesh, but after the Spirit. Another translation puts it this way. For what the law could not do, since it was limited by the flesh, God did. He condemned sin in the flesh by sending his own Son in flesh like ours under sin's dominion and as a sin offering, in order that the law's requirements would be accomplished in us who do not walk according to the flesh, but according to the Spirit. That's the Holman Christian Study Bible translation. In Hebrews chapter 2. Hebrews chapter 2, verses 14 through 16. It says, for as much then as the children are partakers of flesh and blood, he also himself likewise took part of the same, that through death he might destroy him that had the power of death, that is the devil, and deliver them who through fear of death were all their lifetime subject to bondage, for verily he took not on him the nature of angels, but he took on him the seed of Abraham. And friends, you know, we can do double talk. We can say, well, you know, he did take our nature, But then when we say that our sin is our nature, then we have to start making all kinds of adjustments and issues. And these things tie together, and systematic theology says that they should tie together indeed. Ellen White puts it this way, and she makes it very simple. In Medical Ministry, page 181, she says that he, referring to Jesus, took upon his sinless nature our sinful nature, that he might know how to succor those who are tempted. He who had a sinless nature took upon his sinless nature our sinful nature. Medical Ministry 181. And of course, we could look in many other issues concerning this Christology that is so contrary to common theology, proper theology in the mainline churches, because in John 3:16 it says that Jesus is the only begotten Son of God. But you see, if he's really a Son of God, that means God is really a Father, doesn't it? But the Bible says that there's one Father and one God, right? But then again, well, wait a minute now. If Jesus was born of the Holy Spirit is the Father, or is the Father the Father? Now we have two fathers, we don't have one Father. There's all kinds of confusion. And everything starts to cascade and tumble together. But now I want to talk to you a little bit about eschatology, last day events. And I just want to show you, because we're talking about pioneer beliefs in Sabbath school, and we're going to be coming to these a little bit later. But I want to show you what fundamental belief number 7 was. That the world's history, from specified dates in the past, the rise and fall of empires, and the chronological succession of events down to the setting up of God's everlasting kingdom are outlined in numerous great chains of prophecy, and that these prophecies are now all fulfilled except the closing scenes. In other words, the study and the understanding of prophecy was vital to our early Adventist people, right? But you see, friends, there's a lot of people today who study prophecy, but they don't get it right. So it's not just enough to study prophecy. We need to study the prophecy, but we also have to get it right. Statement number 13 said this, that as the man of sin, the papacy, remember I said we'd make reference to 2 Thessalonians later, 2 Thessalonians chapter 2, the man of sin, that as the man of sin, the papacy, has thought to change times and laws, the laws of God, Daniel 7:25, and has misled almost all Christendom in regard to the fourth commandment, we find a prophecy of a reform in this respect to be wrought among believers just before the coming of Christ. And then they give Isaiah 56, 1 and 2, 1 Peter 1:5, Revelation 14:12 as references, as well as other references that could be listed. And so they understood that this man of sin was the papacy. And this was with great unanimity and later with entire unanimity believed by our people. But it's no longer so. It's no longer so. In fact, you may or may not realize it, but when you study the current 28 fundamental sets of beliefs, neither one of these beliefs that we just read are involved. In 1931, Wilcox removed those. And they're not there. And so you can believe anything you want about the papacy, or not believe anything you want about the papacy. You can believe anything you want about Revelation chapter 13 and Daniel 7. And you can be a Seventh-day Adventist in good and regular standing. You could say that the beast of Revelation 13 is Donald Trump. You could say it's the candy man. It doesn't matter. You're still in good and regular standing. Well, friends, you're not with historic Adventism. And neither are you with Ellen White. Because Ellen White stated this, and this is from The Great Controversy. This is the beginning of a paragraph on page 356, and I'll have the rest of it on the next slide. But she says this, the Apostle Paul warned the church not to look for the coming of Christ in his day. That day shall not come, he says, except there come a falling away first, that the man of sin be revealed. 2 Thessalonians 2:3, so there's your reference again. Not till after the great apostasy and the long period of the reign of the man of sin can we look for the advent of our Lord. The man of sin, which is also styled the mystery of iniquity, the son of perdition, and that wicked represents who? The papacy, which is foretold in prophecy, was to maintain its supremacy for 1260 years. This period ended in 1798. The coming of Christ could not take place before that time. Paul covers with his caution the whole of the Christian dispensation down to the year 1798. It is this side of that time that the message of Christ's second coming is to be proclaimed. So, we were told that our early Adventist believers said that there were great chains of prophecy. Not just one line of prophecy, but several lines of prophecy. You have Daniel 2, Daniel 7, Daniel 8 and 9, Daniel 11. You have Revelation 13 and 14 and 17. You have these chains of prophecy, these apocalyptic prophecies. But now you start to go mess with one, and friends, you know, because they are so intricately linked to the others, if you're going to be consistent, you've got to start to change the others too. Right? And so if the papacy is no longer the beast of Revelation 13, if it's no longer the man of sin, if it no longer has an issue to do with the mark of the beast, then you've got to start changing everything. Maybe it hasn't happened yet, but it's going to happen. If you're consistent, you follow theology, systematic theology, right, it will happen. It's guaranteed. Also, in Great Controversy, on pages 443 and 444, it was apostasy that led the early church to seek the aid of the civil government, and this prepared the way for the development of the papacy, the beast. Not just any beast, but the beast. Said Paul, there shall come a falling away, and that man of sin be revealed. 2 Thessalonians 2:3. So apostasy in the church will prepare the way for the image to the beast. So, do you think Ellen White was clear about this? Now we want to talk a little bit about exegetical theology. Because all these things, again, they tie together. And exegetical theology really ultimately deals with inspiration and how we relate to it, where it comes from. While the canon, we believe, has ended, has inspiration stopped? And further, is God dependable? In Ephesians chapter 4, Ephesians chapter 4, verses 11 through 13, we read verse 14 earlier, but it says, in starting in verse 11, that he gave some apostles and some prophets and some evangelists and some pastors and teachers for the perfecting of the saints, for the work of the ministry, for the edifying of the body of Christ, till we all come in the unity of the faith and of the knowledge of the Son of God unto a perfect man, unto the measure of the stature of the fullness of Christ. Now, I want to ask you, friends, when does this finally all culminate? When does this perfect man finally culminate? In the end of time, right? And so God has given us these gifts. He hasn't ceased to give us pastors, has he? He hasn't ceased to give us evangelists. But now we have an assault on Ellen White, on this gift of prophecy. Because the dragon, you see, is wroth with the woman and went to make war with the remnant of seed which keep the commandments of God and the testimony of Jesus Christ, Revelation 12, 17. But in Revelation 19:10, we are told that the testimony of Jesus is the spirit of prophecy. And the dragon is wroth with that spirit of prophecy and has been wroth with it ever since John gave the revelation. And he's wroth with it today because the spirit of prophecy unequivocally says that the papacy is the beast of Revelation 13. It is the man of sin of 2 Thessalonians chapter 2. It is the little horn of Daniel chapter 8. And all the way through. And further, it says that its mark of authority is the mark of the beast. And Satan doesn't like that. And so he invents all kinds of ways to get our minds diverted on different channels and different ideas. And yet we say it's okay to believe this. Believe whatever you want about it. I don't believe that for a minute. Our early pioneers believed in spiritual gifts. Mm-hmm. Belief number 16, and this is part of it, and I'll give you the rest in a minute, that the Spirit of God was promised to manifest itself in the church through certain gifts, enumerated especially in 1 Corinthians 12 and Ephesians 4, that these gifts are not designed to supersede or take the place of the Bible, which is sufficient to make us wise unto salvation, any more than the Bible can take the place of the Holy Spirit, that in specifying the various channels of its operation, that Spirit has simply made provision for its own existence and presence with the people of God to the end of time, to lead to an understanding of that word which it had inspired, to convince of sin and work a transformation in the heart and life, and that those who deny to the Spirit its place and operation do plainly deny that part of the Bible which assigns to it this work and position. Does that make sense? Makes perfect sense to me. Because it's what the Bible says. You see. Now, God cares for his people. Amen. And he cares for his ministers. And he wants his ministers to give the trumpet, friends, not a discordant note. He wants them to give a certain sound. And he wants them to do this so much that he gives them a very fearful warning. In Ezekiel chapter 33 and verse 8. Ezekiel 33 and verse 8. When I say unto the wicked, O wicked man, thou shalt surely die, if thou dost not speak to warn the wicked from his way, that wicked man shall die in his iniquity, but his blood will I require at thine hand. In other words, friends, if I know to warn the flock, if I'm not trying to warn that specifically that one who's in the wickedness, then he will die in his sin, yes, but then I also will share that blood. And that's why this is important to me too. I have a vested interest in this, but it's not my primary reason. Now, you're familiar with the statement of Ellen White's, and that's a statement that says, error is never harmless, it never sanctifies, but always brings confusion and dissension. It is always dangerous. Have you ever heard that statement before? It's in volume 5 of the Testament. I'm going to read it to you in just a minute. But I'm going to give you just a little of the background to what's being said first. Because we oftentimes hear this statement, but it's been seldom I've ever heard it in its context. And I think to be fair today, it would be good to show it in its context, okay? She's writing to a Brother D, but I believe his name was maybe Brother Ramsey, but it's called Brother D here, or maybe Randall or something. But anyhow, that which Brother D calls light is apparently harmless. Now, I looked this up in the formerly unpublished writings, and there seems to be no explanation specifically of what this brother is speaking about. That's not given in the context of the original. But that which Brother D calls light is apparently harmless. So here's the background. It's something that appears what? Harmless. It does not look as though anyone could be injured by it. But brethren, it is Satan's device, his entering wedge. This has been tried again and again. One accepts some new and original idea which does not seem to conflict with the truth. He talks of it and dwells upon it until it seems to him to be clothed with beauty and importance. For Satan has power to give this false appearance. At last, it becomes the all-absorbing theme, the one great point around which everything centers, and the truth is uprooted from the heart. And then she continues in Volume 5 of the Testimonies on page 292. She continues, and she says, no sooner are erratic ideas stated in his mind than Brother D begins to lose faith and to question the work of the Spirit which has been manifested among us for so many years. Now, this gives us a little hint that something he's dealing with is against the spirit of prophecy. Because it's against the spirit that God had been manifesting in the movement, you see, all those years. Okay? Let me read it. No sooner are erratic ideas started in his mind than Brother D begins to lose faith and to question the work of the Spirit which has been manifest among us for so many years. He is not a man who will entertain what he believes to be special light without imparting it to others. Therefore, it is not safe to give him influence which will enable him to unsettle other minds. It is opening a door through which Satan will rush in many errors to divert the mind from the important truth for this time. Did you get what she said? She says, he uses this as an entering wedge. And then what he's going to do, he's going to have an influence, and he's not going to be quiet about it. You see? He's not going to be quiet about it. He believes it's truth. He's going to share. And then he shares these things that are going to divert our minds from particularly important truths, and this is all coming in because Satan is behind it. Brethren, as ambassadors of Christ, I warn you to beware of these side issues. Every tendency is to divert the mind from truth. And now she says, error is never harmless. It never sanctifies, but always brings confusion and dissension. It is always dangerous. The enemy has great power over minds that are not thoroughly fortified by prayer and established in Bible truth. Volume 5 of the Testimonies, page 292. You can read it yourself. You don't have to believe me. Right there it is. Now, as I was studying in the book Acts of the Apostles, I ran across this statement this week, and I think it's a very good statement. It's on page 580, and she says that after a time, the zeal of the believers began to wane. She's speaking about the early century of the Christian church. After a time, the zeal of the believers began to wane, and their love for God and for one another grew less. Coldness crept into the church. Some forgot the wonderful manner in which they had received the truth. One by one, the old standard bearers fell at their post. Some of the younger workers, who might have shared the burdens of these pioneers and thus have been prepared for wise leadership, had become weary of oft-repeated truths. Let me pause there for a minute. She says coldness crept into the church. So is there an implication maybe they needed more love, right? But I want to ask you a question. Your house is burning down. Do I just tell you, you know, Brother Allen, you got beautiful flowers in the front of your yard and don't tell you your house is burning down? Is that love? Is that really love? I mean, that's craziness. It's craziness to say that we don't love because we speak the truth. We speak the truth in love. The Apostle John was called the Apostle of Love. But no one dealt more strongly with heresy in his epistles than John did. I mean, John, he made Paul look very powerful at times. I mean, John would say, look, if they don't bring you the doctrine of Christ, don't allow them in your home. Well, that doesn't sound very loving, does it? But this was from the Apostle of Love, because that's what love does. Love tells the truth, even if it hurts, because it's important. Because we'll not be sanctified by error. We'll be lost by the error. And we need the truth, friends. That's what we need. We need the truth. Well, let me continue. She says, in their desire for something novel and startling, they attempted to introduce new phases of doctrine, more pleasing to many minds, but not in harmony with the what? Fundamental principles of the gospel. In their self-confidence and spiritual blindness, they failed to discern that these sophistries would cause many to question the experience of the past and would thus lead to confusion and unbelief. Now, I could tell you that I have a ministry. And I could tell you that this ministry has been dedicated to the restoration of the principles that God gave us as a people in the beginning. Right? I could say that. But if I am starting to then undermine those principles, principles about spiritual gifts, principles about the papacy, principles about justification, sanctification, principles about sin, the nature of Christ. Am I really trying to bring a restoration of the principles, the fundamental principles that established us as a people? Or am I really taking us on a new ride? What would I be doing? Beloved, all truth is important, but especially the fundamentals. And when you mess with those, you will cause untold issues, but especially those fundamentals that build upon others. And God is calling us, friends, to take a stand and to not allow souls to be lost through our silence. And my question for you is, will you believe the truth? Will you love the truth? Will you live the truth? And will you defend the truth today? May God help us. We need His help.